Acclimatization is the process in which an individual adjusts to a gradual change in the environment. For example, if you hike 10,000 feet and spend several days at the altitude, your body will acclimatize to 10,000 feet. Although, if you do not start hiking low on the mountain and ascend slowly, the pressure in the pulmonary arteries are increased. This then forces blood into portions of the lungs which are not normally used. Therefore, it is best to start hiking low and ascend slowly so your body can adapt to the decrease in oxygen molecules at a specific altitude.
Altitude sickness will most likely occur around altitudes above 8,000 feet. It is an illness that can range from a mild headache to a life-threatening buildup of fluid in the lungs or brain. Acute altitude sickness is the most common form. It is caused by ascending into higher altitudes too fast for body to adjust. It can also be triggered by exertion, dehydration, hypothermia, and consumption of alcohol. Symptoms of altitude sickness include fatigue, headache, dizziness, insomnia, shortness of breath, nausea, decreased appetite, swelling of extremities, and social withdrawal. One way to avoid it is to allow your body to adjust to higher altitude, so basically take it slow. Also, it helps to drink water and consume a high carbohydrate diet. To treat altitude sickness, delay further ascent up the mountain, rest, and stay warm. You can also take a Tylenol or something similar to help. If symptoms worsen, it's very important to descend down the mountain. Advanced high altitude sickness can result in pulmonary edema.
Cerebral edema is when water content in the brain rises, causing pressure to build in the skull. Cerebral edema almost always begins as acute mountain sickness and because the brain is surrounded by the skull, the oxygen supply can quickly be cut off as the blood vessels become squeezed. This can lead to death as the brain cells become damaged and die. The symptoms of cerebral edema in order of appearance is confusion, changes in behavior, fatigue, difficulty walking as well as speaking, vomiting, hallucinations, blindness, seizures, unconsciousness, total paralysis, and a coma. Symptoms appear suddenly but can be recognized by a change in breathing patterns. Cerebral edema must also be treated quickly to prevent permanent damage or death. The individual must also descend immediately while being given oxygen as well as intravenous fluids and medications. Surgery may also be needed to shunt fluid out of the brain or remove a piece of skull to relieve the pressure.
The effects of pulmonary edema can start taking place at 8,000 feet above sea level. It can affect hikers and skiers who start exercising at higher altitudes without being acclimated first, and may happen after a few days. At low altitudes, healthy lungs are enough air pressure to fill the alveoli and make the blood oxygenated. The lungs are under lower pressure at higher altitudes, taking more oxygen that they can filter and make the lungs work harder. The increase of power in the lungs increase the rate of the pulmonary artery. Blood vessels in the alveoli will start to constrict to move blood to areas that need more blood flow. The blood may also pump rapidly through delicate alveolar capillaries. The thin membrane wall separating the capillary from the alveolus starts to leak fluid and rupture. Plasma then spills into the air sacs, which cause the person to drown. The symptoms may occur suddenly or develop slowly. People may have a sensation of drowning or suffocation and will be gasping or wheezing. They may also have a cough that produces a frothy sputum that produces with blood pigments. These symptoms may come with rapid, irregular heartbeat, pale skin, sweating, headache, and fluid retention. Because of these signs, they may wake up at night feeling breathless and feel relieved when sitting up. There are a few treatments to this. Descent to lower altitude may be the best treatment, but if you need an immediate alternative and still choose to ascend, using an oxygen tank and rest would be most effective. This increases oxygen levels in the blood and lowers the pressure in the lung blood vessels.
Frostbite sets in when the body is exposed to temperatures of or below 0 degrees Celsius. Frostbite not only occurs at a high altitude, but also in low temperatures, as long as the wind chill factor compensates. Climbers are often mistaken by thinking that it is not frostbite because they often have numb limbs for periods of time. Symptoms vary between the three different stages of frostbite: frostnip, second and third degree frostbite. Frostnip occurs when the victim will experience a tingling sensation at the affected locations. The skin will turn very white and become soft and flaccid. There is no blistering during this stage and no permanent damage. Frostnip is reversible. Superficial frostbite is when they begin to notice blistering and a numb and waxy sensation in the skin. The affected body areas will also feel stiff and inflexible. Deep frostbite occurs when muscles, nerves, tendons, blood vessels, and even bones may freeze. Deep frostbite often leads to permanent damage. At this stage, there is usually no blistering, but no sensation can be felt in the affected areas. Treatment. Get indoors in a warm place as soon as possible. Cover the victim with warm blankets. Immerse the affected areas into warm water, not hot water. Warm the affected areas using body heat. Try not to rub or massage the affected areas, as this may cause further tissue damage. Do not try to increase the body's temperature by using fire, heating pads, or stove. Affected areas have no sensation, and this may cause them to burn easily. Once the affected areas have been washed and dried, wrap them in sterile bandages to prevent infection. A doctor may prescribe oral antibiotics or ointment to further prevent infection.
Hunter reflex is a physiological condition where in cold weather, the blood vessels in extremities allow blood to flow to the extremities, thus keeping them warm and useful, rather than the normal response, which is to withdraw the blood from the extremities to protect the core. The body's initial response is to constrict blood flow in efforts to prevent rapid heat loss. However, if the body can't or won't remove the body part, and it continues to cool, the blood vessels will dilate again. This causes loss of extra heat in the core to prevent the loss of a limb. If further cooling occurs, vessels begin to alternate between dilation and constriction. This provides irregular blood supply as compromise to conserve both heat and limb. However, if low temperature persists, and the hypothalamus senses the body temperature is low, it will signal vessels to remain constricted, allowing limb to freeze. The Hunter reflex is more well developed in those whose limbs constantly contact water, for example, Sherpas. This is a place where I feel dehydration occurs when the amount of liquid a person loses is more than they gain. At higher altitudes, it's a lot easier to become dehydrated. Higher altitudes mean lower air pressure, which results in more rapid evaporation of moisture from skin surface and from your lungs. In addition, most high altitude areas are also very low in humidity. Both these factors mean the higher up you are, the more water you need to keep body functioning. Dehydration causes abnormalities in sodium and potassium levels in the body, which can lead to problems in the heart rhythm. Signs of dehydration include lack of perspiration, dizziness, shortness of breath, nausea, headache, and fatigue. To treat and prevent dehydration, drink a lot of fluid, especially water. Avoid drinking coffee, tea, alcohol, and sugary drinks. You should bring twice as much water as you think you need. If symptoms worsen, then you should descend immediately. Dehydration can become very serious if left untreated and can result in hospitalization.
Hematocrit is a blood test that measures the percentage of blood volume. Measurements depend on the number of red blood cells and size of cells. Normal levels in men are from 42 to 54%, and women are from 38 to 46%. When people ascend, levels become higher and meant that there is an elevated red blood cell count. At high altitudes, blood production is stimulated. This blocks thirst and prevents the person from taking in any extra water. Blood becomes almost 70% solid, which increases the risk for heart attacks. Knowing the hematocrit levels at high altitude are vital in order to know if elevating could put the person in danger of a heart attack or other health problems. Snow blindness can happen anywhere with snowy or sunny conditions, especially on glaciers, mountains, and high alpine environments. On high altitudes, ultraviolet rays are enhanced in the thin air. When they reflect off the snow into a person's eye, the cornea gets sunburned and becomes opaque. Brightness that comes in contact with the eyes can exceed 10 to 15 times the amount of light that the eyes are comfortable to. This is common with climbers who lose their goggles or take off their goggles from fog buildup. The eyes may become bloodshot and have increased watering or tearing. They may also swell shut, have uncontrollable twitching, and pain. The victim may claim that they have the feeling of sand or grit in their eyes. Snow blindness may cause temporary loss of vision, but can cause permanent blindness in the extreme cases of repeated exposure. If a victim has not developed a severe case or had overexposure, they should wear sunglasses to prevent any extra damage. Ideal sunglasses to have would be 99 to 100% UV absorption, 5 to 10% visible light transmittance, large lenses that fit close to the face, a wraparound side shield to prevent incidental light exposure, and an anti-fog lens cleaner.